We're going to open the City Council work session for November 20th, 2017. The first item on the agenda is an announcement of a presentation at the council meeting, which is Monday night, November 27th at 7 o'clock. The New York State Department of Environmental Conservation is planning to make a presentation to the City Council regarding their rollout plan for the upgrades at the water treatment facility. So they'll be here to make a presentation about the plant upgrades, and I hope they'll be able to answer any questions that City Council members may have.
That's about the filters, Michelle?
The carbon active.
Granulated carbon
active, yeah, the GAC, GAC.
Granulated activated carbon.
Okay. All right, then we're going to move into the engineering items for tonight, and the first item is a proposal with Quest for asbestos abatement monitoring services at Washington Lake and Masterson's Park.
Good evening. We have two abandoned trailers, one at Masterson's Park and one at Washington Lake, that we want to demolish. And previous testing revealed that there is asbestos in the roof of one trailer and then in the window caulking of the other trailer. So this is a proposal with Quest to apply for a variance with the New York State Department of Labor and then the air monitoring services that go along with the abatement, which we'll bid out at a future date.
Those trailers do what? What's in them now?
They're vacated. They're abandoned. They're in a state of disrepair, partially collapsed, and liabilities for the city.
So this is just a demolition?
Well, we want to demolish them, but we have to abate the asbestos first. So we'll do the demolition in-house once we get rid of the asbestos.
And then the next item is a proposal to accept the transfer of the New York City Department of Environmental Protection land use permit for Catskill Aqueduct connection improvements at Browns Pond from the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation, and it would be transferred to the City of Newburgh.
So over the past year, the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation has funded and constructed a number of upgrades at our Browns Pond water pumping station. That's the location where we obtain water from the New York City Aqueduct. Those improvements that were constructed by the DEC are located on New York City Department of Environmental Protection property, so City of New York property. The DEC had a temporary land use permit from the DEP to construct those improvements for the benefit of the City of Newburgh. Now, this is the process for the City of Newburgh to accept those improvements and transfer the permit from the DEP permit from being in the name of the DEC to the City of Newburgh so we can go on the property and maintain and operate those improvements.
Good.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Jason. Okay, the next items are from the Finance Department. And the first item is also related to our water supply situation. And so, as you know, we have a contract with the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation to reimburse the city for the cost of the water that we are using from the New York City Catskill Aqueduct. This item tonight is for a one-year extension to that agreement.
Now, does that mean they don't have to pay us back until a whole year after we thought they were?
No, it just continue what we're doing. We're asking for reimbursement every quarter. They're giving it to us every quarter. It ended on October 31st, so we're extending it for another year.
Right, so, and we're still taking water. We still need reimbursement, so we have to go through the formality of extending the term of the agreement for that reimbursement. The next item on the agenda is a proposed budget transfer from a legislative body to the Human Rights Commission.
So this was a request from Councilwoman Mejia with regards to the Human Rights Commission and some seed money for which we would move to the trust account, which would allow them to start, not even start, but maybe, do you want to explain
it? So this is coming on the similar to what other council folks have done that have not used their travel, their conference travel allotment. The Human Rights Commission is in the process of sort of reinvigorating and launching itself, so this would be used as part of that seed function. They're getting ready to launch the National Human Rights Day coming up in December, and so this is one of those sort of avenues or laying the path to them becoming you know, fully functional with some resources attached, so as that they're not depending on the city for budget items allocation, which is something that, you know, we have not gotten to the level of being able to allocate funds for commissions that carry out charter sanctioned work.
And just to, for the numbers, it's $728, which is the same amount that we've used for all the other council members that have moved monies.
What I would say is, you know, the first year that the Police Community Relations Board was in effect, they didn't have an allocation or a budget to work from. And in the second and third year, we were able to make a proposal to the council for some funding for them to do education opportunities, to do some, to get some training for themselves and to work out in the community. So what we're trying to do here is, absent formal budget allocation, is Council Mejia is trying to give them, the Human Rights Commission, some funding to be able to carry out their mission.
Thank you.
And then while, thank you for putting it on.
No problem. While I was looking at the work session, there, it just doesn't seem like the budget is on there. So I just wasn't sure, are we just going to wait till we get to the end of this to just bring up where we are and what changes have taken place since the last time we met? Or do you want me to just brief you on them now?
You're here now. You might as well go.
Well, so I thought that was part of the special meeting that we're having.
We can. I just wasn't really sure, only because I didn't see it on this, so I know there had been some emails going around.
Since you have the opportunity here to ask questions and to talk to Katie in your normal work session format, that if you wanted to take that opportunity during the work session format, that you'd be able to do that. That's all we're asking. If you're not, if you prefer not to, that's fine too.
I think it's important to hear what you have done, what you've been working on.
So in essence, basically what we've done is we reached out to the actual incumbents coming in to find out what level of health insurance that they were going to be interested in when they came on. And just to keep it simple, we kept Councilwoman Holmes's health insurance in because we just didn't know back in October who was going to come on. And because we kept all of hers in, and these incumbents coming in are taking single rather than family, it was almost a wash for three employees to come in at a single, and we were able to eliminate the family package. It's a little bit more, a couple $1,000 more, but nothing like the 100 that we didn't know back in October.
The 100,000.
Correct. So in the event that three people would have come in that all wanted family packages, it would have been $28,000 for their health insurance, plus about another $1,500 on eye and dental. Oh. So we were able to wash, for the most part, with plus or minus a couple $1,000s. So that's where we are. In addition to what we proposed last time with the keeping of the jobs, same 4-cent decrease on the homestead and zero increase to the non-homestead.
So what council members that have been elected recently, which ones did you reach out to? Did you reach out to just one, two, or all three?
All three of them.
You reached out to all three.
Yep, and they all gave me, this is what they were planning on coming on with the health insurance in January, and what level they were going to take.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
right, so when you did your estimation in October,
right,
I get it that she must have had the family plan?
Yes.
Okay, because right. I'm like, I think you have to be a student in college full-time in order to get certain benefits.
You have to have dependents, and dependents are usually defined as spouse, a spouse or legal partner, and children, or adopted or natural-born children, up to age 26.
Oh.
Up to age 26. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that, I had asked about that for myself, and they said no till 21, that you have to show proof that they're a student full-time.
I believe
that. Yeah, I went up and down the stairs.
Well, we'll check the night shift handbook, but I believe that the changes in healthcare over the last couple of years is if they qualify as dependent, Right. You may be able to keep them on up to age 26.
Yeah, yeah. I'm aware of that recent law under the Obamacare.
Well, we'll check the NYSHIP manual.
Yeah, please make
I'll
sure.
I'll double check
but,
it.
But yeah, the same thing that we have, whether we have we have dependents or we have, you know, single.
Right.
You know, I believe that the incumbents should, the incoming elected officials, you know, we need to, if we have to, make a motion to, and a resolution so that it goes as planned, because I can't see anyone on the council not having insurance.
Well, yeah, with the adoption of the budget, as
right.
you know, we would make that change, which I've already done on the back end. I knew where you guys were leaded last Thursday. So it's in without the, you know, so we were.
Just hope nobody, the incoming council members, don't get married.
Well, I mean, that happens
all the time,
unfortunately. You know, the budget is always a snapshot of where we are at the moment, and when that happens, then usually there's something on the offset. Somebody changes from family to single, and so we have to make some moves to, you know,
all right, but we
got to
make sure that that language is clear. So like Councilwoman just said, we don't want them to.
Now, once they take the coverage, then any changes in the coverage have to be done in accordance with the NYSHIP manual, and we would have to follow that. So once you're in the pool of coverage, changes have to be made in accordance with the NYSHIP manual, which has to be in accordance with law, and we would have to cover that. We wouldn't be able to not do that.
Okay, good. That's fine. Good. Yep. Good for them.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Thanks, Katie.
Thank you.
Okay, then we'll move on to planning and economic development, and the first item for that category is a proposed license agreement with Scenic Hudson for trail improvements to Crystal Lake and Snake Hill. So that's okay. It takes a few minutes.
So as you probably know, the city of Newburgh owns half of Snake Hill and Scenic Hudson owns the other half. And they've been a wonderful partner recently. And they're interested in developing trails around Crystal Lake and opening up the land and taking care of it. Now, that would go over part of the land that we own, and therefore we'd need a license agreement to open that. But it's the beginning of a trail system, you know, an invitation into the out-of-doors for families and young people and so on. So they want to
wonderful.
Do it. It's no cost to us.
Yeah. First of all, it's no cost, but also it's part of my great hope in my retirement, which is going to start any minute now, to get the...
Stop threatening us.
To do the... you know, we had this whole thing with No Child Left Behind, supposedly, with our education system. I feel it's just as important to have No Child Left Inside.
Yeah.
I want to work with our students, and especially in South Middle School, which is an arm's length from my house, to do things outside and go out and hike and go out and see our environment and learn about the environment and how important it is to them. And I think that this, first of all, we started already a little bit. We did a terrific cleanup of Crystal Lake thanks to the Boy Scouts just a couple years ago with Max Marwin and his troop. He was part of his Eagle Scout project.
Year and a half to 2 years
ago,
yes.
And they also built a part of the trail. They blazed a trail going up a ditch to the extension of Ellis Avenue. So, but to have a group that knows what they're doing like this and to come in and build a real trail and maintain it would be just a wonderful thing for our kids to be able to walk around.
And just so you know, they're working with the Boy Scouts. They're also working with Center for Hope, to garden and to improve these trails. So,
great.
Okay.
Okay.
The next item is scheduling a public hearing to hear comment on the city's potential application for a Restore New York grant to help redevelop the Dutch Reformed Church and the City Club.
So the city is eligible to apply. It's only municipalities, not counties, that can apply for Restore New York monies. And this is to rehabilitate buildings in your downtown district. We had two. The first step is to put in a an intent to apply, and the cities can put in two or more. You can only put in one grant, however. And so we put in two, SUNY Orange, for their three buildings. And the DRC and City Club with Alembic. The Alembic is further ahead. As you know, you've had the environmental statement in front of you and so on. They're further ahead in their movement. The SUNY Orange is, has asked to wait until next year. We'll start meeting in December and talking about it. So this is a potential to put in for $1 million that would have to be the city putting in for. It would be then managed by the developer of your choice when we get to a development agreement. So all of this concurrent moving forward, but none of it.
It would be additional funding to help rehabilitate the Dutch Reformed Church and then whatever the end use of the City Club to support that redevelopment as well. So this particular grant application is a little different. It does require the council to hold a public hearing. So what you have in front of you is a resolution that you would be that would be on the agenda for November 27th that would schedule the public hearing at your first meeting in December.
Wouldn't hurt to apply for the money, right?
Absolutely.
Who would not want the money? Go ahead.
Have a ball.
Well, and I guess depending on how things go, then it would certainly makes us more competitive for potential development of whoever may come down the pike.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Have they still been around the city?
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
You will. You'll see more and more.
It's so cold now.
Yeah. You know, we haven't a done deal with them yet. We don't have a developer agreement, so there could be more.
Next. And then the next item is the purchase proposal for 7 Locust Street.
So this is in your packages. This is a small house on Locust Street. Hello. Small house on Locust Street. It is a city employee. He's in the audience, I think. I saw Jimmy here. Do you want to come up, Jimmy? Oh, yeah. Jimmy works in code. Has worked for DPW in sanitation and now is in the code office. He's looked at this building for a few times.
Right.
It is a small house. It does need work. It has some mold. It has a few other issues. But it's a basically nice little house there on Locust Street. And he is offering to buy it from us for $25,000.
Great.
Any questions?
No questions.
It's nice to have a city employee buy a house here.
Yes. Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
Okay. All right. And the next item is the proposed agreement between the Newburgh Ministry and the City of Newburgh for the operation of the warming center at 104 South Lander. So based on the proposal that we presented at the last work session, I've translated that into a more formal agreement between the two parties. And we're looking for the council to approve this on November 27th.
I have a question. At the last meeting that we had, I didn't see any figures. How much we're going to, I see the insurance part of it, but how much are we, the city, gonna give?
Well, the city is not, what your agreement in your packet entails, we're not at this point putting up money to run a shelter, nor are we putting up staff, nor do we have the expertise to do it. Okay. We would be contracting with the Newburgh Ministry to do this.
The cost to the city would be whatever repairs are necessary to make the building
usable
for this purpose. So we're not going to be, so if the you know, if there needs to be some minor repairs to make sure that the heating system is working properly, that the windows are sealed, and that the plumbing is working, that would be the city's contribution to this program.
George, but this also, to say too. George also, Harrison wants to say
exactly. Something. Also, the elevator and the sprinkler system. So anyway, George.
Yes.
The building is not in bad shape. It certainly needs repairs before it's up to code to open as a shelter. But our hope is that this is a temporary measure, and then we'll move on to the next use of the building, and we'll look for long-term homeless shelter, hopefully on Johnson Street, adjacent to the Newburgh Ministry.
Hopefully we get money from the county to do this, because the county is the one that has social services department, not the city.
That's correct.
So I just can't see, I mean, I'm to vote for it, as long as I know it ends in March for us, but roof was bad, there was two windows were blown out, it was a miserable place to put human beings, I thought, and I know because my office was there.
Yeah.
So. Is all that stuff going to be fixed before these
Yes,
folks
it has in? To be. It has to be. Before.
And is it coming out of CDBG funds?
No.
Out of what?
It would be coming out of the county funds. We know that there's a $25,000 county allocation, which was approved from the county commissioner from Middletown.
Right. Berkman.
Yes, Berkman.
Jeff Berkman.
And we're told, we've had a couple of calls, not to my office, but to... to the executive office, that the county is standing behind another funding. So
we hope to receive outside funding to help make the building suitable and to help fund the operation. The Newburgh Ministry also is going to be using the county funding and the housing funding to provide the staff and the supplies to operate the shelter.
And I hope it's better have track of than it had been in the past on our part, because I just today went in there and took out 18 different keys that were lying on the so-called kitchen counter.
Yeah.
All kinds of different keys to the front door. And I gave them in a little Ziploc bag to Naomi Faye, hoping she'd give them to George to either just throw away. There you go. Or whatever. But we want to make sure that the people that are allowed in that building are the people who are supposed to be there.
Absolutely.
From now on.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So then the next question that I have is, we talked about the operational part of it. Now I know that there have been people who have been barred from the ministry. So will they be allowed to go over to this 104, being that it's the ministry who?
I wouldn't pretend to be an expert in managing any of these programs, but I would assume from what I do know that everybody gets a fresh start. If they, whatever offenses they might have committed before, if they do it again, they might be barred again. But
because, I don't want
something
like that. But
they're not barred at the beginning.
Right, I don't want that to carry over into this building that's going to be for, people that need the assistant and
of
to
course.
Get out of the
of
cold. Speaking with some transients, they're like, oh, I can't go to this certain place. I can't go to that certain place. Yeah. But we seem, as humans, I'm not going to say all, but we have some kind of stigma like, oh, you did this. You can't come over here. Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure that's clear. Once we open up this building.
I understand what you're saying. I certainly do.
Good point.
So, and then too, if we could make the language clear, and if we can have the Newburgh Ministry to sign something saying that we're not responsible for X, Y, and Z, just make it clear, because I know that they're gonna come up with different things. And if it does,
I think that's in the agreement.
There is an indemnity provision, a safe harmless provision in the agreement that the parties would be responsible for the conduct of their own employees, agents, and contractors. So we're only going to be responsible for the building, and if we do have people who are there operating. If we're not, it's not our responsibility. If someone that the ministry brings in is responsible, then the responsibility stays with the ministry. So each party's only responsible for the resources that they bring into the agreement and into the project.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
And then the last item is a discussion item, and this was sent to me by Councilwoman Holmes. She received a request from the family of Pastor Minnie Powell, who ministered at the church, the FBH Church of God on Grand Street, seeking to create or name an intersection as Pastor Minnie Powell Square. So I have a draft resolution. I don't know if whether you want to wait for Councilman Holmes to be able to speak to it.
Nope. Yes.
All right. So we'll hold this off until the next work session.
I have a comment on it, though, if I may.
Sure, absolutely.
I'm so glad to see that this is phrased as renaming an intersection as Minnie Powell Square, because that's the Boston and the Massachusetts model. I hope that's what they had in mind.
Well, that's kind of, yeah.
It's where they have, you've seen it a million times. I know it's in Worcester, Massachusetts, and in several other places in Massachusetts, where as you're walking along and pedestrian traffic is walking along, they're on a corner at an intersection. You look and it's at eye level or shoulder height. There's a nice, like a post that's implanted and has a plaque, an actual plaque. Sometimes it's got clear plexiglass over it, and it says, this intersection is to honor, you know, so-and-so for such and such deeds that he or she did, and she lived here and there and whatever, and worked here and there. And that would be that's a great way,
that,
I think.
My understanding is that's how Councilwoman Holmes did explain it to the family. So just
wonderful.
As the intermediary, but and the location was just my suggestion as the nearest intersection. So if other people, after going out and viewing, may have some other thoughts, we could further discuss that at the December work session. So that really concludes the open session items on the work session agenda. I do have two matters for executive session at this time.
If I could, just for clarification, after executive session, are you coming back? Okay, just wanted to be sure.
What's that?
Just wanted to make sure after executive session you are coming back so we can really just finalize where we are with the budget and how we're moving forward.
Right, so my only caveat to that is that the public announcement went that meeting would start at 7 o'clock. Unless your two items will take us an hour and a half,
they won't.
Will. Okay, so I don't want to start a meeting before it was scheduled, so we'll have to wait till 7.
I would agree with that assessment. I would not start it early, earlier than what it was announced for. So if I could get a motion to enter into executive session, if we can go downstairs for a couple minutes, it shouldn't take that long. Hillary, do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.